So much, you may be seated. For scripture reading, at the beginning of this service, life celebration of Kenneth Martin Plett, I would like to read one verse from the Gospel of John, chapter 11, verse 25. I was told, and I wholeheartedly believe, that Kenneth Plett loved and liked this verse. John 11, 25 says, the words of Jesus Christ, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. Amen. Let's start with an open prayer. Heavenly Father, you have gathered us to this place to celebrate the life and share some special, precious, sweet memories of our Christian brother, of a father, husband, and friend, to many people in our community and beyond. Lord, we have come to this place to celebrate the life of your servant, Ken Plett, who loved you wholeheartedly and served you until his last heartbeat and until his last breath. He loved you wholeheartedly, and he wanted so many people to get to know you personally as their Lord and Savior. Lord, fill our hearts with your joy, with your supernatural peace, and may this service, this life celebration, be done for your glory. And all God's children said, Amen. Poem by Sharon Plett.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. This poem is based on the scripture verse of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. Though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. And the writer is Johnny Roberts, and I have no idea when this poem was written. I learned it as a little girl. And then through the years, I forgot some of the words, and then I found it on the internet. So today I'd like to read it in memory of Ken. And for Sue, here's the poem that was read to me a lot of times in my childhood by my Scottish grandma. Okay. They say that I am growing old. I've heard them tell at times untold, in language plain and bold, but I'm not growing old. This frail old shell in which I dwell is growing old, I know full well, but I am not the shell. What if my hair is turning gray? Gray hairs are honorable, they say. What if my eyesight's growing dim? I still can see to follow him who sacrificed his life for me upon the cross of Calvary. What should I care if time's old plow has left his furrows on my brow? A better land, a better home not made with hand, awaits me in the glory land. What though I falter in my walk? What though my tongue refuse to talk? I still can tread the narrow way. I still can watch and praise and pray. My hearing may not be as keen as in the past it may have been. Still, I can hear my Savior say and whisper soft, "This is the way." The outward man, do what I can to lengthen out life's short span, shall perish and return to dust, as everything in nature must. The inward man, the scriptures say, is renewed day by day. So how can I be growing old when safe within my Savior's fold? Ere long, my soul will fly away and leave this tenement of clay. This robe of flesh I'll drop. I'll rise to seize the everlasting prize. I'll meet you on the streets of gold and prove that I'm not growing old.
I'll get you to sing along with me a hymn, and it's called In Christ Alone. In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when strivings cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. I'll get you to stand with me as we sing this. In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, the gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood
of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
Thank you. You may be seated. Tributes. Now it's time for tributes. Precious, special tributes, sweet memories from grandchildren, siblings, and children. Grandchildren first. If you have a tribute, yes.
Hello, I'm Jordan, Jody's son, Jason's stepson. Fourteen years ago, my mom got engaged to some guy named Jason, and I found out that I was getting a new family. I thought, oh great, a bunch more aunts and uncles and cousins whose names I won't remember. Never been great with names, and yes, that means that if I met you today or sometime this week, I'm probably going to say nice to meet you every time we meet. Actually, I've probably introduced myself to you guys multiple times already, despite having met you several times. Before I met my new family, I thought, these random people aren't going to be a big part in my life. They're only step family, right? Not real blood. And then I met them, and they took me in as if I was their own. And then I grew up with them, and I took them in as if they were my own. Actually, at this point, I actually kind of forget sometimes that I'm not part Canadian. I never had step aunts or step uncles. I had aunts and uncles. I never had step grandparents. I had Nana and Papa. I'm going to be honest, I don't remember the first time that I met Ken and Sue. I thought about asking if anyone does remember when I met them, but I kind of like just imagining that they've always been there. Kind of like having memories with this family as though they were always my family. I remember Ken towing me around on a bicycle with me on a skateboard when I was dumb enough to ride a skateboard and Ken was reckless enough to tow around a child on the back of it. I remember driving Ken through the neighborhood when I had first gotten my learner's permit while he was silently freaking out in the passenger seat because I may or may not have been driving just a little too close to the cars on his side of the road. I remember playing board games with the family, and for some totally unknown reason, I would always win when Ken would be my partner. Still don't know what that was about. But I don't remember meeting him, and I like it that way. The best thing I'll always remember about Ken is that I never saw him get old. The entire time I knew him, he acted like he was still in his 30s. Riding bikes, letting 16-year-olds drive him around, and allegedly cheating at board games. He was always on his feet, cooking soup for his family, or fixing things around the house that nobody asked him to fix, using random junk he found to make it functional, albeit ugly. I'll always remember him as my 35-year-old grandpa that, for some reason, looked 72. I just want to say thank you to him. Thank you for taking me in like I was his blood. Thank you for being an inspiration. Thank you for being my real grandpa, not just my step-grandpa. And for showing me that you can get older without getting old. Unfortunately, my brother Jensen couldn't make it here to say goodbye in person, but he is here with us on a video call at the moment. He wanted to say something, so he sent us a video. That's him. If you guys could play it.
Hi, everyone. I'm sorry that I wasn't able to be there with you today. You guys are all in my thoughts, and I wish I could be there with you. I wanted to at least record this video to say a couple words and share some memories and moments that I've had with Ken. I think the first one is that I think he was the first person I actually heard say A in a sentence. Living in South Florida, nobody says A, and it was a really cool stamp of Canadian authenticity that was stamped on this new family branch that my mom had created through Jason. As humans, I'm always amazed about how the small interactions we have with each other can seem so insignificant, yet have a massive impact. Something you say, something you do, the way something is said, the little moments that you might not think anything of could stick with someone forever and potentially lead them down a new path. Ken and I first bonded over a project that we had with my band at the time. I had this idea to build these, I wanted these lights that would sync up with the show as we performed. And he was quick, really quick to volunteer. He was excited. Anyway, we ended up building these lights together, and he thought outside of the box and found a way to build not just one, but we built two lights 6 feet tall for $70. If I would imagine custom lights for a show would be hundreds of dollars, but somehow he was able to think outside of the box, get really creative, and find a way to build these 6 foot tall light towers for $70. And they were strong too. I mean, we went on tour, we played 28 shows, I think, on this tour, and we used them every single night. And on the road equipment take a beating, so they held up strongly all the way to the end of tour, and they're still operational today. There was another time that I remember Ken volunteering for another project, and this time he was supposed to fix the sliding glass door. So my mom leaves the house and he gets to work. By the time he was done, that door, I mean, it slid really well, but he had gone outside, found a stick, and screwed that stick into the door handle. It was like blatant, what? It was one of the funniest things I've ever seen. But, oh man, when my mom came home, you should have seen the look on her face. It was, I will never forget that moment. It was so funny. As I grew up a bit more and I learned to appreciate family time a lot more. So every time we were together, we would always play family board games, table games. And Ken would always deny it, but we would always catch him cheating in those board games. I mean, I remember one specific time where we were in teams, and he was talking to his team across the table, and he was kind of doing like this motion over the board, over a very specific section of the board, almost like he was trying to hint where his teammate should go. And I mean, whether it was actually cheating or not, that doesn't matter. The fact is that those little moments brought laughter to the table and made the night so much more entertaining. And all of these small, seemingly insignificant moments that we had together, the lights, the games, the door handle. All these small, seemingly insignificant moments have always stuck with me. They helped define the way I approach different situations and problems by actually, they taught me new and creative ways to think outside of the box. And I wanted to say thank you for that. Thank you for the lessons that we both didn't know you were teaching. Thank you for the laughs. Thank you for the kindness. Thank you for having such a big heart and being so welcome. And thank you for everything that you've done. I'm so grateful to be able to have met you and shared these moments with you. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I will be sharing my three great memories out of a lot more about my grandfather. So back when I was a little guy, I would just go for bike rides with him, just sweet little rides around the town of Arden. My grandma would sometimes come with us as well. We'd ride down to the park and maybe catch a frog or two, and I would take them back with them and put them in their garden. Another memory I have with my grandpa is that during the summer, a few times, we would go down to the gravel pit by the Huttery Colony and just pick up rocks, hand-sized rocks, and we'd just smash them into bigger rocks with, and just leave them. We just smash that bigger rock with that smaller rock, and by the time we were done, we'd just have a bunch of rocks and pieces in a pile. And my last memory, I also a fairly recent memory in July, is when me and my grandparents and my dad went on vacation to Wisconsin Dells during July. During that trip, we all went to the Noah's Ark Water Park and had some fun. We also went go-kart racing, and Grandpa just so happened to pick the fastest kart as well. And while we were racing, I was just behind him, and his hat flew off onto the track. And so one lap later, I just snatched it up on the way by and gave it back to him. I love you, Grandpa, and I will miss you.
My name is Arden, Jason's son. Papa was ingenuitive. When I was younger, I didn't have much for him to fix, but I did have Pinewood Derby cars that needed to be built. And of course, Papa said that he would help me with them each time. The second time in specific, I wanted one of the cool, slender cars that won the races the previous year. I didn't want the normal looking one. And that's all I could tell him, is I just wanted the cool looking slender cars. And he said, "Well, do you trust me?" And I said, "Of course." And so he started sanding, and we started building and decorating, and by the time it was finished, I had a Winnipeg jet. He said, "Well, that's the coolest winners you're going to get." I did not win that Pinewood Derby race. Papa was also adventurous. I have never been a super active kid. I always preferred to stay in my room playing video games or watching TV, but that never sat well with Papa. So he would find things to get me active. When I was younger, he would write up a list of secret treasures around the neighborhood, and we would go on a treasure hunt looking for duck feathers or mushrooms or cool-looking rocks. And we would just go through the neighborhood and look. And each time we found something, I got across one of the treasures off my list. While I was up in Canada, he would also keep me active. I never rode a bike down in Florida, and so each time he would come up here and he'd pull out the bikes and he'd say, we're going to go for a bike ride. And each time I'd have to relearn how to ride a bike. And each time he would have to sit there and wait. And I could tell he was losing his patience each time. But he would wait. He would take me around Arden going on the bike rides. I typically would use Nana's bike, which was always just a little bit too big for me. One time he said, we're going to go to a quarry, which I now know is just a gravel pit. But he took me down to this quarry, and we played looking for rocks, smashing rocks for about an hour. And then on the way back, there was this huge hill, which I guess wasn't that big, since he was at the top and I was still at the bottom trying to get up the hill. And again, I could tell he was losing his patience, since I did not know how to ride the bike as good as he thought I should. Papa added adventure to my life, and he made it fun when I was bored sitting around in my room doing nothing. Thank you, Papa. You'll always be loved.
Hi, I'm Grace. Every time I saw my papa, he would pull me into a big hug and say, now there's my favorite granddaughter. Sometimes it would be at random times, but there was always a smile and always a hug. He would ask after I knew why I was his favorite, and I always answered, it's because I'm your only granddaughter. But then he'd pull me closer and grab both my hands in his, and he'd whisper, I'll tell you a secret. Even if you weren't my only granddaughter, you'd still be my favorite because you're who made me a papa. And I always believed him because I knew in my heart, even if it was a joke, that my papa loved me that much. Even if it was a bit selfish of me to think that. And I'd squeeze his hands back and say, I know. And I would think about how large my papa's hands were curled around mine, how his calluses from all the years of fixing everything would scrape against my own. And I would think about how gentle his hands were with mine, and yet strong and assertive. Think about all the things his hands did, how he cared for his garden, how they worked on so many projects, how they made homemade noodles and hung them across the house, how they held my Nana's hand, and how much love I could see in the smallest of gestures. My mom told me that before I was born, she had sworn I would be a boy. But my papa insisted he kept having dreams about holding a little girl's hand. And he did. He held my hand as he told me the secret, and he held my hand as he said goodbye. And I wish I could have held his hand one last time just a bit longer. I wish I had replied that he was my favorite papa too. But I think he knew, and he's looking down on us today from heaven with that silly smirk he always had wore on his face. And maybe this ruins our secret we had, telling everyone about it now. But Papa never whispered very quietly anyways, and it was never a secret how deeply he loved.
Our Christian brother Ken Platt was blessed to have lots of siblings in his family, wonderful siblings, and now this is your time.
We were going to, I asked Susie if the brothers or the siblings could give a tribute, and she said, yes, would you please? And then I brought it to the brothers and asked them, we've been requested to give a tribute to Kenny, and who's going to do it? And Peter immediately said, I ain't doing it.
That's right.
and John looked at me as, what are you talking about? Elvin was on my mind, but he had a mind someplace else. And then finally, I think it was Gilbert that said, well, Dennis, you're his twin. That's natural for you to do it. Well, yeah, I guess it would be. But I find it hard to talk about Kenny in this situation. Thanks for the tributes. You stole my thunder. And because Kenny was innovative. He thought out of, I like that, he thought out of the box. He was curious. He was a tinkerer.
A rascal.
I'm a rascal. Yes, he was. Somebody asked me after Kenny died, asked me if there was some kind of a psychological, psychedelic, or whatever they call it, connection between me and Kenny. And I said no. And yet, I think there was. I think there was. Were we close? Yes, and maybe no, and yes, I think so. We were always in the same grade. Of course, we got born together at the same time. Though actually, in all honesty, I was born on the 31st, and he was born on the 31st, and I was born on February 1st. But I still call him my twin. Did we compete? Yes and no. We did a bit of competing. In school, no. Not a whole lot. But someplace along the line, someplace during our teenage years, I suppose, I had, someplace along the line, had bought a pair of boxing gloves, two pair actually of boxing gloves. And they were the 16-ounce, the big
pillows.
Yes, that's what they were. Anyways, we spent many hours in the evening pounding up on each other. And sometimes they went very long because if it was him that won the last round, then no, we're not quitting yet. Then I would say, no, we're going on, and back and forth it would go. Yes, he was a thinker and had a lot of ideas, great curiosity. Quite clever he was, actually. Radios, electricity, that was his fun and game. I can't remember this, but I remember my brother reminded us yesterday that he took a pair of scissors, I think, a pair of scissors and cut an electric cord, and it was live. That was Kenny. I remember Kenny and having this brilliant idea that he would take electric cord and strip the ends, plug it in, and put one end in one bottle of water and the other end in the other bottle of water and see what would happen. He loved to tinker with radios and stuff like that. Model airplane, he was the one, I think, that got us into, my brother, those youth control airplanes, him and I bought it and flew around a lot with that kind of stuff in circles and stuff like that. Fixed radios at the time, now this is a long time ago, and I realize that for the younger generation, you probably don't understand what I'm talking about, but radios used to have tubes in it, and Kenny and I would tag along, I think, more often than not. We would get uncles and aunts would have radios, tube radios, and they didn't work, and we would get them, and all we had to do is pull the tubes out and take them to the hardware store someplace in Steinbeck, and they would have a tester system, and we would buy the new tubes and put them back in the radio and give them back to the uncles, and they were amazed. This is going to be, he was quite, reckless sometimes, too. I remember the one time somebody had talked to us about mixing diesel fuel and fertilizer and making something go boom. And so him and I tried it, and we got fertilizer and diesel fuel and mixed it, and didn't know diddly squat about the whole thing, and it just never would go bang. And then somebody said, well, you have to have a bit of a concussion, and so we got some firecrackers, put it in it, but it wasn't a big enough bang. We somehow or other, we couldn't ever get a concussion big enough to set the thing going, and the Lord be praised for it. We grew up, I'm sorry guys.
Keep on.
We grew up in a Christian home. Mom and Dad dragged us to church every time, every opportunity, and every time the door opened, we were in the car going to church. We learned how to sing. We did a lot of singing, and we enjoyed it. We knew about God and His love. Kenny knew about that as well. Christian home. We had an example before us. And yet, in all of the shenanigans that Kenny would get into and up to, Kenny knew that he needed a savior and a salvation, because there was something about Kenny that maybe was a lot quicker for him to realize than for maybe the rest of us. He had a way with words, speaking his mind, and that would get him into trouble. And of course, because of that, he probably maybe realized his sinfulness quite early, but with joy in his heart, he realized too that Jesus had paved the way. He came to understand the need of his salvation, and he embraced it. He saw Jesus, and that Jesus had died for him. Kenny was one that he'd see things and he'd be quick to fix things. And sometimes he would make a mess, yeah. We had dabbled with radio in high school and stuff like that. And I remember having a fairly keen interest in electronics, and I had sent an application to the DeVry Institute in Toronto to take electronic training. And so a guy came and talked to me about going to Toronto and stuff like that. And then I went and told Kenny about it, and Kenny said, well, we ought to do that. And then he realized, no. He wanted to be involved in mission work, seeing the gospel go to all the different language groups. And of course, that was the thing that he had gotten, I think that information, or that stuff he had got because our aunt had died in Bolivia, I think, and the funeral, that impressed him so much. He wanted to be involved in missions, and so after high school, him and I headed off to Bible school and further missionary training. And someplace along the line, he found himself a wife. I did too. And then after mission training, he headed off to Indonesia, and we went off to Papua New Guinea. But someplace along the line, I had gotten involved in ham radio, and I got there actually before Kenny did, and I got my ham radio, and I somehow or other contacted him and let him know that I had an amateur radio, and he didn't have one. I had one up on him. Anyways, he got an amateur radio, I got an amateur radio set as well. We set it up, and I think it was three times a week him and I would talk. I was in Papua New Guinea and he was in Indonesia, and we would fellowship together and talk about all the difficult things we had to go through with other people in the world. I think it was, what was it, some 15 years that he was, they, you spent in Papua New Guinea? 10? So I beat him on that too. We were nearly 15. And they came, he came back to Canada and worked Plett Construction for a bit, and then he got involved with Manitoba Telephone System, and he worked with them for...
I don't know if you worked.
For how many years? 17 years, there you go. But during that time working for Manitoba Telephone System, he never lost the burden in his heart for mission work and so forth. And he and Sue would very often in the winter times, but that not, was not while he was working for MTS, I suppose that was later, they would go to Florida to the mission headquarters, and they would spend a couple of months every summer, every winter, and helping, tinkering at the mission headquarters in Sanford, Florida. Matter of fact, it was this thing that the one thing, being involved in mission was the last thing that he really was involved in. Just maybe a week before he went on to be with the Lord, he spent a weekend with missionaries in Steinbeck. And then he said goodbye. What he set his mind to do, he would do, Kenny would do, right from the start. And I said this yesterday, right from the start, even in the womb, when it was time to go, he left and left me behind. I was second again. And here we are. He's gone and has left me behind again. Now we're going to try to sing a song, Sweet Beulah Land. It was a song that he had requested we sing for him, and we'll see if we can make it through. We used to sing a lot together, and we did quite well. I think we did quite well way back when. Now it may not be quite as well, but enjoy it. Enjoy this. Listen to the words, okay?
Be forever, no, Beulah Land. brand new song of joy divine. And so she joys just in knowing that soon these pleasures will be mine. Beulah land, I'm longing for you. And someday on thee I'll stand, where my home shall be eternal. Beulah land, sweet Beulah land.
We did it.
My family and I would like to thank everyone here for taking the time to be here today to celebrate Dad. We have been blessed with prayers, calls, texts, flowers, food, and visits. The love and care from so many has been truly appreciated this past week as we mourn and plan for today. A little bit of repetition, but a few words that come to my mind when I think about my dad are passionate. He had a passion for the Lord, family, missions, and sports. Ingenuity, along with frugal. He loved to help. He loved to help out by fixing. Dad wouldn't go out and buy parts for something first. He would try and fashion up something that would work with items he found. My dad was intense and determined. He'd leave no stone unturned until he found a solution. Whatever Dad decided to invest himself in, he did so 120%. My father was also disciplined. He would work until things were done, and he would not quit. A memory I have of him is that I had broken a door handle. It's a lot of door handle story, right? Okay. I had broken a door handle and one day, and he fixed it with, well, first of all, I said, Dad, I broke my door handle. I need to go buy a new one. And he said, well, let me have a look at it, honey. And I said, okay, but we should just go to Home Depot and buy a new one. And he's like, well, let me look. And then he said, do you have a lid off of a can of soup? And I said, yeah, I do. And so I went and got the can, and no sooner had I got the can lid from the recycling bin did he screw it into the door and fix it and have everything all fixed already for me. So he said, see, I saved you some money. I'm like, thanks, Dad. He never ceased to amaze me. Very often, when he was particularly proud of a fix, he'd call me over and say, look, sweetie, this works slicker than snot on a brass doorknob. And I would agree, but I was always, Dad, that's pretty crass. He always had a funny saying, and some were a little more crass than others. I miss you so much already, Dad. But the legacy you left will live on in our hearts always. I'm honored to have known you and to have called you my father. My mom has asked me to speak on her behalf today. So these are the words of my mother. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. James 1:17. God is a good father, and I was firsthand witness to God taking a shy, awkward farm boy and placing him in the amazing gifts that made him into the man he became. A man of confidence, of curiosity, of love. I don't want this to be just about my wonderful husband, but more importantly, our wonderful God who has made it all possible. Ken was the ninth child of 11 children that were born to Peter and Elizabeth Plett, living in southern Manitoba. He was the firstborn of the second set of twins in the family. Ken loved being a twin because he said he always had a friend. Ken said he was taken to church before he was born and had always heard about God and his need for a savior. It was his brother Alvin that finally helped him take that step into a personal relationship with God. He who is given much loves much. Ken thanked God daily for his forgiving grace. Ken and I have experienced the goodness of God in our lives and for more than 52 years. If there was ever a marriage made in heaven, it was ours. When I planned to be a single missionary, my home church could see that I wasn't making decisions very well, so began praying for a husband for me. And boy, does God sure know how to pick them. Ken was a prairie farm boy through and through. He loved the wide open spaces and loved working in the dirt, cultivating beauty through his beautiful flower gardens. His heart was to please God. When his Aunt Suzanne, who was a missionary in Brazil, died, the call was to take her place. He wanted to go where the love of God through Christ's death on the cross had never been heard. Ken is not a patient man, and when he decided to do something, he did it. We had our first date in March, engaged in April, and married in August of 1970. He always told me that he wondered what in the world he was thinking when he was taking his young bride halfway across the world to Indonesia with very little financial backing. But God is faithful. He gave us two beautiful children. The Indonesians called them Coffee and Cream, Jason and Daisy. He had a lifetime of experiences in that beautiful island country where we served with New Tribes Mission, now Ethnos Canada, from 1970 to 1982. We returned to Canada in 1982. And God provided a little house on the prairie for us while Ken worked with his brothers in construction. Ken was a fixer. He could fix anything, and if he didn't know how, he'd find a way because of his dog determination. He was good at construction, but it wasn't his passion. He loved a challenge and was a problem solver. So he trained in the telecommunications field. This opened an opportunity to work for Manitoba Telephone, where he labored for 17 years until he retired in 2008. God used this time as a field service technician to get over his shyness and begin to really enjoy meeting and getting to know people. Ken was a soup maker, and many knew this, as I was always giving it away and sharing it with others. He would make a big pot at the beginning of the week and that was our daily lunch fare. There was a jar left that our family ate together in his memory, and he was a good provider. Ken loved his wife and family. It was reflected by his daily prayers for his children and grandchildren. He loved serving them by fixing things or doing things they needed around the house. He, with the help of his brothers, John and Gilbert, he completely remodeled our house just last summer. Ken was not one for quiet. So he came into the house, when he came into the house, he always put on some kind of music or a radio. He also loved music, and I had the privilege of personal serenades as he played his auto harp. Ken wanted to retire at 60 so he could volunteer for missions ministries. He actually retired at 59 when MTS offered him a year's salary. If he retired early. This took us to Florida during the winter months, so we could not only volunteer at the mission headquarters, but visit family and friends who lived there. There he developed deep friendships and honed his skills in the electrical field. We also served in Brazil for a couple of weeks and returned to Indonesia for a year. We continued to volunteer for Ethnos Canada, helping in the member care department. Though Ken by nature was a homebody, we enjoyed our travels to many places in Canada. The United States, Israel, Philippines, Mexico, the Caribbean, and even China. These trips enriched our lives with many friendships all over the world. Psalm 139, 16 says, "Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." What I wouldn't give for one more day with my soulmate, my lover, my friend. But God's way and timing are perfect. God called him home Monday, February 27th, in just the way he wanted it. He wanted to go first and quickly and at home with his beloved by his side. Ken, you will live on in my heart through precious memories we share over the years. Forever and always, your loving wife. Those who went on before Ken were his parents, Peter and Elizabeth Plett, Sister Elvira, brother-in-law Jim Bailey, and many treasured nieces and nephews. Ken will lovingly remembered and sadly missed by many, but especially his beloved wife Susan, son Jason and Jody, daughter Daisy with Rob, and grandchildren, Jensen and Sarah, Jordan, Grace, Arden, and Carter. His siblings, Lillian, Evangeline, Alvin with Martha, Gilbert and Alice, Les and Sandy, John and Sharon, Peter and Cecile, Dennis and Donna, Reg and Charlene, and many nieces and nephews and their families. Donations can be made in Ken's memory to Ethnos Canada, the mission they served with. It will be placed in a fund for Indonesian missionaries to assist with their flight costs. Thank you.
Oh, good, they put some tissue up here for me. Before I start, I want to echo what Daisy said and thank you for everyone that came. I recognize a lot of faces here today. And there's a lot of people that I don't know, but I know that my dad touched your lives. And so thank you for coming here this morning to remember him. You should be here standing
with your arm around me here.
Cutting up, cracking a cold beer. Saying cheers. Hey, y'all, it's been a good year. It's one of those moments that's got your name written all over it. And you know that if I just had one wish, it'd be that you didn't have to miss this. You should be here. Cole Swindell penned this song in 2016 upon the sudden passing of his father. He had just signed his first recording contract, and he was out on the road when he received his call that his father had been killed in an accident. Cole's father sounded a lot like mine. My dad was fiercely proud of all his kids and his grandkids. There wasn't a place that he would rather be. He loved every one of us, and he could not wait to be with us, to put his arms around us and give us a big hug. In 2009, when he got what he referred to as his bonus grandkids, he loved them and accepted them as if he'd known them since when they were birthed. He did not differentiate or care. His love was great enough for his entire family, regardless of how they became family. He spent countless hours with our kids, taking them on adventures, building canvas frames, light props, or whatever else the kids needed for school or work. And he even spent time biking around the neighborhood, towing them on their skateboards and other things that probably weren't exactly safe, but they were fun. Dad also loved his daughter-in-law. He spent countless hours patiently pausing the television while he was watching hockey with her, teaching her the sport he loved. He would diagram plays for her on a sheet of paper just so she could watch the game with us and know what we were talking about. Of course, my technology is screwing up on me. As you all have already heard, Dad was well known to be able to fix anything or figure whatever you needed help with out. He'd come to our house in Florida and take care of everything that needed fixed or any project that I was too busy to get accomplished. I'd arrive home from work and Dad would be out back relaxing, satisfied with his day's activity, excited to show me what he fixed or accomplished. We'd sit for a moment and we'd talk about my day. I'd tell him about my challenges and my successes, and then he'd show me what he did. And that was always way more exciting or interesting than what I had to share with him. He didn't care. He was just happy to make himself useful. And in the end, I think Dad was never content to sit still and relax. And I think he knew that, and he preferred instead to meet his Heavenly Father instead of not being able to do the things that made him feel alive. My father was the OG of dad jokes. There was not a single soul that he touched that did not know that my dad was a funny man. Not everyone knew how to take my dad's specific sense of humor, a trait that you guys have already seen displayed in his brothers. But when they got to know him, they loved his wisecracks and jokes. Dad would make a joke out of anything. And as we started to remember this week his sayings, we realized that a lot of them were of the PG-13 nature. But that endeared him to everyone that crossed his path. Many of our friends in Florida would ask after my dad because he left such an impression on them. Some of our closest friends couldn't wait for Dad to visit, just to be excited to spend time with him, talking and joking and teasing him about the son that he raised. Dad never judged. There were many times in my life that I disappointed him. There are many decisions that I made that he did not agree with. But in the end, Dad was the perfect model of our Creator. He always loved me and accepted me and stood by my decisions, fiercely defending me to anyone. His faithfulness never wavered. And even in the most trying times of my life, he refused to condemn me. He was the rock of our family, and it will be hard to replace his zeal and enthusiasm for the things that we accomplish. I am so thankful that I had the opportunity several months ago to come home and be with him during the most trying times of his life. I did not know then that this would be the last time I'd get to hug his neck and tell him I loved him. Cole Swindell continues in another verse. They say now you're in a better place, and I would be too if I could see your face. Dad, I love you so much and will miss you tremendously. You should be here.
Makes me smile. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see.
First of all, what can you say? Praises be to the Lord for the life of his faithful servant. Thank you very much, dear friends, for coming to celebrate the life and testimony, the witness of our Christian brother, Ken Plett. I think I told yesterday to the family members that my message would not be longer than 75 minutes, and I need to keep my word, otherwise I would be the liar. And the liars, it's in the Bible, will not inherit the kingdom of God. So I have to be quick and short. We'll see how it goes. So for the message, for this short message, I picked up the text, the Lord gave it to me, from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. And the title of this short message can sound like this: the comfort of Christ's coming. The comfort of Christ's coming. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Let me tell you at the very beginning of this short message. Sometimes, in fact, pretty often, especially in recent years, if not a decade or two, the ministers of the gospel, the preachers of the gospel, can be pressed down or pushed down not to preach the gospel, even at the celebration life services or funeral services. A real personal story. Once I was told not to make the life celebration service into a crusade by the family member of the church member who had passed away, who had gone to glory. Right before the service, somebody came to my office and told me, do not make it into a crusade. Will you please? And you have a few minutes before that service and you're just thinking in your heart and mind, now what shall I do? Whom shall I listen to? I prepared the message in my heart and my mind, and here's a close family member asking me basically to do something different. This morning, this afternoon, my heart is at peace My mind is at peace. I don't have to play a hypocrite. In fact, my Christian brother Ken Platt, he was not a hypocrite. He was pretty direct. He was pretty honest. And he was a man of prayer. And he was a man of curiosity. I could have seen that for 2.5 years. I've got to know him. And he had a good sense of humor, if not irony. Don't get me wrong. He had enough time. The Lord gave him enough time to finish his work, his ministry in our church as the head of the Missions and Outreach Committee and a church council member. And it was really funny when it was a council meeting and at the end of it, we were asked, my wife and I, to leave. Don't get me wrong, but I'll never forget. I'll have another chance to ask him this question, why he said it the way he put it. He told me, okay, well, guys, let's raise the pastor's salary and go home. So that was his suggestion to finish the church council meeting quicker. So, and there were many other episodes when God just showed me so much through him. I remember some episodes when we used to have the men's prayer meeting. And there were a couple of episodes, couple of Wednesday mornings, when it was just me and Ken. And I remember particularly one morning I felt kind of a little bit downhearted. We tried different timing. We tried, you know, to invite men to come and pray for an hour or so with some devotional time. And I remember Ken came a couple of times. It was just me and him. And I asked him, well, it's just me and you. He told me, yeah, but that's okay. But there's somebody else. And I got it and I told him, yes, Jesus promised, even if there are two or three of you, I will be in your midst. And I will be in this gathering of my children. Ken Platt has been a member of this First Baptist Church, Nipoa, for many years. Ken was a faithful member of this congregation, head of the Missions and Outreach Committee in recent years. He has been just a good Christian brother to me, a source of tremendous spiritual support and prayer. So we have read this passage already from 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. The reason Christ is our hope. The reason Christ is not hope for all people, for all humanity, but only for those who put all their trust, all their hope in him, in the risen Savior and Lord. Let me ask you this afternoon already, this question. What do you have for hope in your lives? Who is your hope? Where is your hope? Seriously. In this passage, we have read that those who had gone before us in faith, the dead in Christ, they would rise first. And then those who are alive, who would be alive at that time and remain, should be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet with the Lord in heaven. In this time, when we're feeling some pain, emotionally, physically, some loss, the Holy Bible offers us so much comfort, hope, encouragement, and victory. In this passage we have just read, God's Spirit through Apostle Paul offers reason to hope to those Christians who lost their loved ones. And I would like to make a couple of just points in this short message. Based on this text, based on verse 13, we can see one thing clearly, that as Christians, we have a different reaction, response to physical death. And our different response and reaction to physical death is hope and joy. Hope and joy, verse 13. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. Many of you probably have attended many funeral services, and you probably have witnessed so much grief and weeping and crying and tears and agony and pain. Based on this book, based on the Bible, believers in Jesus Christ, they do have hope. Even if our physical life is over, it's just an open door to the eternity with Jesus Christ. Apostle Paul addresses those in the church, including us today, who lost their family members or friends. Paul tells them that they should react differently than those people who have no hope beyond the grave. I think it's a scary, it's always been a scary life to live without faith, to finish your earthly life without faith. If you talk to many people nowadays, they will tell you, well, there's nothing after physical death. My body goes to the stove or to the grave, and that's it. Really? Seriously? Then such life really does not have any sense, any meaning. Life does have a meaning. Here we ought to keep two things in mind. Our mourning as people is very natural. We grieve, we weep, we cry, we're emotional human beings. The Lord knows our loss because He experienced it with us. Remember the story of Lazarus' resurrection in the Gospel of John. When Jesus, God in human flesh, saw the faces of people weeping and crying, He wept Himself. In fact, this is the shortest verse in the Bible, John 11:35, only two words. Jesus wept. Only two words. Jesus wept. As Christians, we believe on the basis of God's word that departed believers in Christ would be resurrected. However, we still grieve and miss them. I will be missing Ken. I've known him for 2.5 years, but he's been my dear brother in Christ. We will be missing Ken Plett in our church. We will. So next missions and outreach committee and church council will be a little bit different. Another point I would like to make based on this text, that our rejoicing as Christians is supernatural. Apostle Paul reminds us that we have to react differently as compared with those people who have no hope. Yes, we mourn. Yes, we grieve. But the Lord is with us through all of this. As believers in Jesus Christ, we have comfort and hope in the future. We know based on God's word that our fellow believers who passed away are now with the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5:8 says, we are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. When a Christian, not a person who claims to be Christian, but a real, true child of God, dies physically, his spirit, his soul goes to be with the Lord. Another encouraging and comforting verse, dear friends, can be found in Revelation 14:13. Then I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, write, bless the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works follow them. That they may rest from their labors and their works follow them. In verses 14 through 17, we can read about this reality of physical bodily resurrection. Apostle Paul reminds us that if we believe in the gospel and the good news of Jesus Christ, we also believe in the second coming of Jesus Christ. Nothing can be more comforting than this message, that Jesus is coming again. To believers in Jesus Christ, it's a great hope and comfort. He's coming to take us home for where we belong to. For the unbelievers, it's a very scary message, because for them, he is going to come as a judge, to judge them for all their idolatry, rebellion against God and his will. It is a true hope that only we as Christians have, hope of resurrection. In verses 14 and 15 in our text, Paul tells us that Jesus will bring those who sleep in him. In verse 16, Apostle Paul writes about the triumphant return of Christ. When Jesus comes for the second time, he will come wrapped in glory and splendor with an earth-shaking shout of the archangel and with a trumpet of God himself. And let me ask you, who will be the first to see these things? The dead in Christ. Then in verse 17, then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, so we shall always be with the Lord. So we will be reunited with our fellow believers whom we lost, and all together we will be united with Christ for the rest of eternity, as it says, so shall we shall be always with the Lord, always. This morning, afternoon, we're naturally grieved. We will not see Brother Ken Plett, father, husband, grandpa for some, friend, for a while. As I was sitting and watching beautiful pictures and slides of the blessed life the Lord God has blessed Susan Plett and Kenneth Plett as a couple, I could not stop myself thinking, oh boy, this life in this world is so short. You look around, you turn around, and you're 70. Another turn around, another look, you're 85 if you're gonna to make it. So don't waste your time. But as Christians, we have reason for great comfort. As Apostle Paul says in verse 18, comfort one another with these words, comfort. Let's remind each other that someday we will see Ken Plett again. We will. He'll be jumping and leaping around. He'll be in perfect body, no hearing aids, no glasses, perfectly fine. At the end, I would like to read those two verses from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, we also, since we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and he has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. We're running, all of us, our own races in life. The Lord knows for how long and how far you're going to run. In fact, he is a sovereign Lord and master of every life. He keeps your every heartbeat and every breath. Ken Plett finished his race very well. He died in Jesus. He was saved by God's grace. He was found by God's grace. Ken's soul, spirit, is with the Lord now. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for Ken's life and testimony. Before the prayer, the benediction and the prayer, let me ask you a few questions. To leave you with some good questions to ponder over seriously. When your physical life is over, where will your soul go? Heaven or hell? Ask yourself, honestly. Do you have any hope beyond the grave? Is Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior? Is God your friend or your enemy? Are you at peace with God when your time comes? Are you at peace with God? Will you meet eternity as God's friend, as God's child, or God's enemy? Who is your master? Who is sitting on the throne of your heart? Is that the fallen angel, Lucifer, Satan, the devil? Who is your friend? Or is he your enemy? We have lots of important questions before this life is over. And I cannot stop myself from reading those verses to your attention, friends, because the Resurrection Sunday is coming next month, Lord willing. In the book of 1 Corinthians, we read in chapter 15 the following words. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The stain of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not vain in the Lord. It is not vain. Let me pray, and I will read the words of benediction, and they will be recessional. Creator God, God of the Bible, the author and finisher of our Christian faith, God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, thank you for the life and testimony of Kenneth Plett. Thank you for this service, for the life celebration, for everyone you brought today to this building. I don't know, Lord, maybe some of these people who are sitting right here, they're not your children yet. Maybe their lives are in a big mess, in a big confusion. They don't know where to go for help. But Lord, based on your word, good news, the gospel message of Jesus Christ, you did not leave us in the darkness. You told us to tell the good news to all the people around us. And that's what Kenneth Plett was doing in Canada and Indonesia and in other places. He wanted to share the love of Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ, with other people. Lord, we're still in this world for a reason, to continue accomplishing this great commission of Jesus Christ. Go and make disciples of every nation. And Lord, thank you again for this life, for this testimony, for everyone, for loving us so much that you sent your only begotten Son, our Heavenly Father, to the cross to die for all our sins. So, Lord, this is our prayer. That would be for your glory. The best gift, the best present in memory of Kenneth Plett, that someone who is not a Christian yet would believe in you wholeheartedly before it becomes too late to change anything after this life is over. This is our prayer for the salvation of many. And thank you for this life, for my brother in Christ. Those who are Christians, we're gonna to see him again. We will recognize him. But first of all and most of all, we'll be standing in your holy presence, our risen Savior and Master. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. For benediction, verse 57. But thanks be to God who give us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God who gives us this victory. As a recessional, there'll be this song or melody or soundtrack I can only imagine. So, congregation, please rise if you're able as well.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself do is forever, forever worship you. I can only